like those of Europe today, don't yet exist 5,000 years ago. Then suddenly, 4,500 years ago, you see populations like those of Europe today. And this is an association with a group called the Cortedware, or a culture called the Cortedware, which has affinities to the east, to the steppe. And just here's another summary of the data. The Near Eastern farmers come in beginning 8,500 years ago. This is this orange bar, and all the samples we have almost all ancestry of this type. They then mix with the hunter-gatherers a little bit, about 20% of the farmer of the ancestry of European farmers that we sampled by about 5,000 years ago is of this hunter-gatherer type. And then suddenly, beginning 4,500 years ago, this new green type of ancestry appears, which contains within it this ancient North Eurasian ancestry related to Native Americans. It's now the single largest component of Northern European populations today, and it stays after the arrival of this population. And it comes in very clearly now because we have genetic data from them from the east, from steppe populations. But the moral value of research is defined by its social context, and I think in our time, the scientific study of our past has been a force to explode stereotypes and racism. I'm optimistic that the direction of this work is to promote understanding.
The history of the world is not what we thought it was, and for some it's not the history they wanted it to be. The ancient DNA revolution has changed our understanding of who we are and how we came to be. For the first time in history, we can accurately trace the paths and origins of our ancient ancestors. Consequently, strongly held beliefs about heritage and identity are being destroyed. Nowhere else is this more true than of the Indian subcontinent. It has long been thought that India and the people of Europe shared a prehistoric connection. During Alexander the Great's conquest of India, the Greeks discovered the striking similarities between the Hindu gods and their own. Nearly all of the early Hindu gods of the Rig Veda have a similar counterpart in ancient Greek religion. Since the 16th century, European visitors to the Indian subcontinent have noticed similarities between the Indian and European languages. In 1786, William Jones first coined the term Indo-European and lectured on the striking similarities among the three of the oldest languages known in his time, Latin, Greek, and Indian Sanskrit. He stated that no one could examine all three without believing them to have sprung from some common source, which perhaps no longer exists. The speakers of this common source language came to be known as the Aryans. Today, they are usually referred to as the Indo-Europeans. As I showed in my previous video, and I will show later in this video, recent ancient DNA studies show that the Indo-European languages were indeed spread by a racially homogeneous group. As more linguistic and archaeological evidence came to light about the remarkable widespread distribution of the Indo-European language family and the people that brought it with them, minds began to wonder how such widespread conquests were achieved. These ancient people became the inspiration for the Nazi Party's concept of the racially superior Aryans. The belief that they were a race of blonde-haired and blue-eyed people was largely inspired from the earliest recorded voices of Western civilization, such as Homer's stories of the Iliad and Odyssey, within which it was thought that these people were described. After hundreds of years of debate and some uncertainty, an ancient DNA paper published in 2018 called The Genomic Formation of South and Central Asia has finally proven beyond doubt that an Indo-European invasion that came out of Europe into the Indian subcontinent took place around 1500 BC. The paper followed on from previous papers showing a migration of steppe or Uramania populations into northern Europe. The paper I want to focus on is the genomic formation of South and Central Asia. Let's look carefully at what this paper says. The paper shows that there was a large and sudden movement of steppe-related populations into the Indian subcontinent in around 1500 BC. The paper shows that these populations did not intermix with other Asian populations before their arrival into India. The origin of these people is linked to the corded ware culture that was based primarily around modern-day Germany and Poland, rather than the first Indo-European speakers of southern Russia and the Ukraine. This claim of a corded ware rather than a direct steppe origin is based on both archaeological and genetic evidence. The archaeological evidence shows the appearance of corded ware pottery amongst the Indo-European remains found, whilst the genetic evidence shows individuals were found with the genetic signature of the corded ware populations, who, unlike the populations of the steppes, had European Neolithic farmer ancestry. The paper shows that the invasion was just that, an invasion. It happened suddenly and it happened violently. Y chromosome haploid evidence shows a massive sex bias in favour of Indo-European males. In other words, the invading Indo-European males or the later offspring copulated with a disproportionate number of women relative to their original population size. The received wisdom is that no population group would willingly allow the women to be taken by an outside group without putting up a fight. Therefore, a rapid change in Y haploids is thought to result from conquest or war. The paper shows that these invading Indo-Europeans of the corded ware culture had previously established a wide-scale complex of settlements in South Siberia termed the Sasashna culture, not long before their invasion of the Indian subcontinent. A paper called New Insights into the History of the South Siberian Kurgan People examines the DNA of the people of the Sasashna culture and makes a direct description of their physical appearance. Quoting, "Our results also confirm that at the Bronze and Iron Ages, South Siberia was a region of overwhelmingly predominant European settlement, suggesting an eastward migration of Kurgan people across the Russo-Kazakh steppe. Finally, our data indicates that at the Bronze and Iron Age timeframe, South Siberians were blue or green-eyed, fair-skinned and light-haired people." Here we can see a PCA taken from the data in the 2018 paper, showing the genetic similarity of the Sasashna culture and that of the corded ware culture in Northern Europe. The genetic signature of both populations perfectly overlaps. Scholars have identified the structure of Aryan as a cities built, reproducing the model of the universe, as described in ancient Indo-European spiritual literature, such as the Vedas and the Avesta of Zoroastrianism. The structure consists of three concentric rings of walls and three radial streets, reflecting the city of Kim Yama, as described in the Rig Veda. The foundation walls and dwellings of the second ring are built according to the swastika-like patterns. The same symbols are found on various artifacts within the dwelling. Doors were placed in alignment with the rise and set of sun and the moon. So the original builders could observe at least 18 astronomical events. The preciseness of Akam's spiral building strongly suggests the use of astronomical observatories and calendars. The fortified citadel of Akam dates back to the 17th and 16th centuries BC. More than 20 other structures built according to similar patterns have been found in a large area spanning from the southern Urals region to the north of Kazakhstan, forming the so-called Land of Towns. On one genetic paper after another, the Indo-European expansion further west into Europe and further east into Asia are linked with the corded ware culture of modern-day Germany and Poland, and not the original Yamanaya steppe populations of southern Russia and the Ukraine. It is thought that apart from the initial migration from the steppes into northern Europe, all of the subsequent spreads of Indo-European languages and genes originated from the corded ware culture of modern-day Poland and Germany. These very recent genetic findings concord with some of the earliest thoughts on the Indo-Europeans or Aryans. The German origin of the Aryans was especially promoted by the archaeologist Gustav Kostina, who claimed that the Proto-Indo-European peoples were identical to that of the corded ware culture of late Neolithic Germany. This idea was circulated in both intellectual and popular culture by the early 20th century. In the 19th century, the consensus view amongst scholars was that the Indo-Europeans originated in ancient Germany or Scandinavia, or at least that in those countries, the Indo-European ethnicity had been preserved. The word Aryan was consequently used to mean Germanic, Nordic, or Northern European. This chart from a 2015 paper shows that Northern Europeans are the most closely related to the people of the Yamanaya culture, who were thought to be the original Yamanaya speakers. The recent studies show that it was populations even more closely related to modern Northern European populations who were responsible for spreading the Indo-European languages to India and places outside of Europe, apart from possibly the Hittites. The idea that the Aryans or Indo-Europeans originated or came out of India has never been taken seriously by scholars. There are many reasons for this, but perhaps some of the most obvious evidence comes out of the earliest texts of Hinduism. Despite this and the recent genetic evidence, the idea that the Indo-Europeans or Aryans came out of India was, and still is, a widely held belief amongst Hindus today. Make a YouTube search on the topic and you'll see people struggling to come to terms with these recent genetic facts and the destruction of their strongly held origin myth. In a tweet attacking the main author of the 2018 genetic study, Professor Reich, an MP from the ruling BJP party of India, Swabhyam Swami, says, quoting, "There are lies, damn lies, and Harvard's Third Reich and Co's statistics." Now contrast this with Europe, from where the Indo-Europeans originated, and you'll find that most people have no awareness of their Indo-European heritage. You can say that this lack of awareness amongst Europeans about their Indo-European heritage is partly due to the neoliberal destruction of European identity. Take, for example, the BBC article which covered the release of the landmark paper, The Genomic Formation of South and Central Asia. It explicitly states that the invading Indo-Europeans who invaded India came from a region now known as Kazakhstan. Now, this could be taken as a reference to the paper's claim that the invading Indo-Europeans previously established the Sindhastan culture, which was in the border region between Russia and Kazakhstan. But within the full context of the article, it is a clear and deliberate attempt to misinform and cover up the paper's actual claim that the Indo-Europeans, invaders of India, came from Europe. It is also the case, however, that there is good reason as to why the topic of Indo-Europeans or Aryans is of far more concern to Indian people rather than European people. The ancient Indo-European influence on the culture of the Indian subcontinent is far more obvious, as the Vedic culture and social order established by those original Indo-Europeans continues to exist in some form today. The invading Indo-Europeans brought the Indian subcontinent its main religion, the language spoken by most of its inhabitants today, their written language, wheeled vehicles, and their social caste system that continues to this day. India has basically been defined by the Indo-European invasions that occurred 3,500 years ago. The next part of this video will deal with the post-invasion history and the fallout from the Indo-European invasion. As you will find out shortly, the Indo-European invasion of India not only left a lasting legacy within India, but also in places much further east, in places such as Thailand, Cambodia, and Indonesia. Post the 1500 BC invasion leaves a circumstance in which there is a relatively small Nordic-type population ruling over a huge number of native or so-called Dravidian Indians. It is within this context that the Rig Veda is written, which although very obscure, leaves us with many clues as to how the society became structured. The Rig Veda contains the framework of how the Indo-European minority managed to maintain their domination over the native population. Although Hinduism has changed and reformed over the thousands of years since the Rig Veda was written, the practice of a type of racial segregation and subjugation continues to exist in India to this day.
पैरों से शूद्र अर्यायन बने पैदा हुआ, ठीक है? वेद कह रहे हैं, ये वेद की वाणी, जो हमारी वेद माता है, वही सृष्टि का विधान वही बताती है, ठीक है? तो शास्त्र जो शास्त्र की दृष्टि से जो देखा जाएगा वही ठीक होगा और कोई ठीक नहीं होगा
கொஞ்ச ஒரு மரியாதை போணும்பா பாரம்பரியமா முன்னால முதியோர்கள் அதாவது நம்ம எங்களுக்கு முன்னால இருந்தவங்க வந்து இதுல யாருமே செருப்பு போட்டு போக மாட்டாங்க
The Indo-Europeans set themselves up as a ruling priestly caste called Brahmins and claimed to be the closest to the gods. After all, to be able to control society is to be able to control the minds of those within it. Control of literacy and religious knowledge was clearly of the utmost importance to the ruling Brahmins. The colour system of the Rig Veda was the precursor to the modern day Indian caste system. Ancient Indian society became structured and separated on the basis of race and skin colour.
उनके यहाँ पे काम करने जाते हैं हाँ। तो वहाँ पे पानी मिलता है आपको
हाँ।
खाना मिलता
खाना
है,
मिलता हाँ। है पानी मिलता है
उनके साथ बैठ के खाते हैं
ना बैठ के कैसे खेले भंसाम खाएगा हम बाहर नहीं खाएगा
हाँ। अंदर नहीं जाने देता शादी ब्याह पे बुलाते हैं
शादी ब्याह क्या बोले तो
खाली कमाए
घर शादी ब्याह तरह क्या बोले तो कमा भेज लो तो अपन घर जा शादी ब्याह क्या बोले तो शादी ब्याह में
क्यों
तो मुसरनी है ये है मैं चाहे जितने हम राजपूतनी है कि हम बामहिनी है कि
We do know that widespread mixing occurred upon impact of the invading Indo-Europeans, largely through male misogamy. Remains of unmixed Indo-European individuals have been found that post-date the invasion period by over 400 years. This would suggest that the ruling Indo-Europeans saw importance in protecting their genetic lineage legacy by preventing racial mixing with the indigenous inhabitants. This inference from the genetic data is supported by the literary evidence in the Rig Veda, such as the colour system and the strong emphasis on birthright and purity. The 2018 paper shows how the Brahmins or priestly caste of India still to this day have a substantially higher amount of Indo-European or European DNA. In the book of the leading researcher David Reich, it is pointed out that the Indians of different castes who live in the same villages have a level of genetic difference 3 times that of Southern Europeans compared to Northern Europeans. The colour system and later caste system clearly owe their origins to the power dynamics of a racially diverse ancient India. The success of its system is owed to its ability to co-opt others into preserving the system by granting them rights and advantages over others further down the hierarchical pyramid.
லெட்டின் கழுவுறதுக்கு போக கூடாதுன்ற ஒரே காரணத்தை வச்சு நாங்க எவ்வளவு கஷ்டப்பட்டாலும் பிள்ளைகளை இந்த நிலைமைக்கு விடக்கூடாது அப்படின்ற ஒரு எண்ணத்தை வச்சு பிள்ளைகளை படிக்க வச்சோம். கடைசியில் எந்த இது நாங்கள் போய் தொடக்கூடாதுன்னு நினச்சோமோ அந்த இதுலயே கொண்டு போய் பிள்ளைய கொண்டு லெட்டின் கழுவு விட்டதுலேருந்து இந்த ஒரு வருஷம் பள்ளிக்கூட போகவே மாட்டாங்க.
In some sense, the success of the caste and colour system is comparable to the financial the success of financial pyramid schemes. In a pyramid scheme, an organisation compels individuals who wish to join to make a payment. In exchange, the organisation promises its new members a share of the money taken from every additional member they recruit, or in the case of Hinduism, conquer. In the 5th century AD, 2,000 years after the Indo-European invasion of the Indian subcontinent, Hinduism and its caste-based social system became the most widely practiced religious order in Southeast Asia. Hinduism became the most adhered to religion in the Khmer Kingdom of Thailand and Cambodia, and also of the populations of Indonesia. The Khmer people Khmer people's founding legend centers around an Indian Brahmin named Kariya, I think I got that right, who marries a local ruler's daughter, a princess named Nagi Soma, thus establishing the first Cambodian royal dynasty. The role of Indian kings and Brahmins in spreading Hinduism to the rest of Southeast Asia is not historically well understood. There is, however, some genetic evidence suggests that there were migrations of Indians to Cambodia and other areas of Southeast Asia. However, I would suggest that the spread of Hinduism to these regions was largely due to indigenous rulers recognizing the organizational benefits of the hierarchical social order inherited in Hinduism. The Temple of Angkor Wat in Cambodia, built in the 13th century by the Hindu Khmer Empire, can possibly be seen as a product of early Hinduism, which allowed a strong hierarchical system with a large subservient labour force. More egalitarian social systems don't tend to lead to the construction of such huge and intricate monuments that serve no economic function, or not much economic function. The temple might not have been possible with older forms of organisational structures. But Hinduism and the caste system had, and to a lesser extent still has, an inherent weakness. It relied on there being an underclass, or lower caste, and this underclass had very little to gain from the remaining part of the religion. The rise of Buddhism in the 4th century AD is often considered a reaction against the brutality of Hinduism on the lower caste. Other parts of Southeast Asia, such as Cambodia, Thailand, that were previously Hindu, are all now nearly entirely converted to Buddhism, without there being any external military influence on this. The arrival of the Islamic invaders into the Indian subcontinent saw mass conversions of lower caste Hindus. Without any military conquest, 13th century Islamic merchants managed to convert nearly all of the Indonesian islands to Islam. And today, Hinduism has the highest conversion rate of any religion. The religion of Hinduism is still strongly linked to race and racial identity. The problem is that the mystery of the Aryan people has now been solved, and they were not the race that many Hindus thought they were.